Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the event. It's a pleasure to be here to give you an overview, really, of what's happening in grey markets and pointers of the drivers that we're likely to see over the next few months as we carry on marketing the harvest of 2013. And really, just to summarise really what we've seen so far, this year has really been about more normality in global grain production. Remember 2012, we had some big extreme issues in the UK, but also globally as well. We had the big drought in Russia, which hit wheat production, but also in the US as well, the biggest drought for 50 years, and that hit a big proportion of global feed grain production and exports. For 2013, though, as the chart here shows, we're seeing a return to normality, a big rebound in North American coarse grain production that's dominated by maize, and that's really increased the supply of grain to the world market in 2013-14. Last year was so extreme that if we look at the demand profile, what we've been used to is this general trend upwards in global grain demand, largely led by growing population, but also growing wealth in the emerging economies and the demand, therefore, for feed grains to feed animals to meet the increasing demands of more people wanting essentially a westernized diet. Last season was so extreme that we saw some quite extreme demand rationing. Demand for grain last year was kept level rather than seeing really any kind of growth, and that was due to the high prices. And the role of the high prices last season was to really regulate the amount of grain that the world could use, because there simply wasn't enough available to meet that demand growth expectation. For 2013-14, with the increase in global grain production expected and being seen in many parts now, the world is expecting to see a return to trend in this global demand growth era. Essentially, as prices have fallen and grain becomes more affordable, and so we're back on trend. There's a bit of a risk here because I'm not so sure if we can see one season of rationing and then go back straight into seeing this demand growth as if nothing happened at all last season. So it remains to be seen how this turns out, but it is a big area of uncertainty for the market. Let's have a look at prices. Of course, we're all aware that we've seen this downtrend in prices in general as we've come through the growing season and into the harvest period, but there's some real unique differences. What we're seeing this year is this a price trend that we really haven't seen since 2009. 2010, 11 and 12, from planting through to the end of the marketing season, there was a general detail. That trend has been somewhat reversed this season because we haven't seen on a global scale any major weather event impacting production. And so the market is taking this bearish, this price negative approach as we come through harvest and to the autumn. Previously to this year, again in 10, 11, 12, what we were used to is a strong influence from maize on global wheat prices. Now, we're not particularly directly interested in grain maize prices in the UK because we don't really produce very much of it. We may import some for usage in the animal feed sector, but in terms of the big picture, we're not really that interested. On a global scene, we are very, very interested in the role of maize in its impact on grain prices. Basically, what we saw in 10, 11, 12 was some weather events impacting maize, and maize had to lift the whole grain complex higher to basically push feed demand away from maize and towards wheat. This season, though, we've seen a more normal grain price pattern in that we have a very negative maize market because we're looking at the biggest US crop coming forward as the harvest now comes to a close. We'll touch on that a little bit. And so that's given a big downward trend in maize prices. Thankfully, though, we've seen, for the farmer, we've seen some wheat issues emerging. And whereas in previous seasons, we've been used to the wheat price strongly correlated to the maize price, wheat has actually started to become a little bit more proactive. And we haven't seen the sheer level of price decline in wheat as we have seen in the global maize market, and that's a really important factor to bear in mind. So we're going to touch on some of the issues right now. Let's just revisit a final slide on prices first, though, and let's just give ourselves a bit of a history lesson. The graph here is looking at the price profile from planting through to harvest, through to the end of the storage and marketing season. And here are the price patterns here that we saw for 2010, 11, and 12. So generally, when the crop got planted, in general, we saw these general increases in price. And to be very, very general about it, That played into the hands of the very traditional farmer selling strategy, in that the vast majority of it was kept in storage for spot marketing. Again, a big generalisation there. What that also did was it served to show forward selling over that period as a relatively weak strategy. And there's a message coming up on this. For 2013, that price trend is very, very different. We started off at the early in the growing season with some very strong prices, feed wheat prices at close to £200 a tonne. But because of that historical feeling on previous seasons that forward selling was relatively weak, and because the price had increased through the growing season, through the marketing season, there was a limited enthusiasm for forward selling. But probably more importantly with that, there was, if we go back 9 or 12 months, there was very, very little confidence in the crop that was in the ground or attempting to go into the ground. So there was very little confidence in the crop, much uncertainty. So probably little in the way of capitalising on that strong forward price. For reference on here, we've got the beginnings of the 2014 prices, the crop that's just gone into the ground. If we exclude the 2013 prices, this is actually some of the highest pre-harvest pricing that we've seen. Now, I'm not going to stand here and tell you whether that price is going to be in 12 months' time. You could pick a number between £110 and £200 a ton, and you might be close. That's the level of uncertainty that we face at the moment. And the key message to take away from this is that if we're going to make the most of volatility as an opportunity, and I think volatility is one of the biggest opportunities facing arable farmers, it's not a threat. If Jude's right, it's definitely an opportunity, because if you think of when markets are stable, they're not stable for very long at high prices. Markets, when they're stable at low prices, because the UK is by far far from being the cheapest producer of grain. So volatility is a huge opportunity. We are not capitalising on that opportunity, because the vast majority of how we trade is based on fixed price forward or spot sales. So very little opportunity to gain if the market rises after a fixed price sale. There is technology out there that should be being used that we're probably not using to our full advantage, and so it's important that we start to see some more innovation to get some more sophisticated grain pricing products. We're starting to see it, we're not seeing enough, and it's something that we should expect to see and upskill ourselves to be using going forward, because volatility is not going away anytime soon. Back to the fundamentals then, and normally I spend a lot of time talking about global maize and its impact on wheat. This season, maize is having a limited impact on wheat, and this is largely why. This is the global maize supply and demand estimates. The green bars here looking at global maize production. This is from USDA. We're expecting the next USDA report out this Friday, and I would expect that they're going to increase their expectation of global maize demand, because especially in the US, it's been apparent that harvested yields have been better than previous expectations. I would also argue, though, that that is already priced into the market. That's being very quickly reported. Demand in the blue bars there also expected to increase, but not to the same extent as production. So we have a surplus in the global maize market, and that's sort of been putting the downward trend on the underlying factor in the grain price. However, it's not all doom and gloom, because if we look at the stock situation, and when we look at stocks, we don't look at absolute stocks, we look at it relative demand, what we call the stocks to use ratio. And this is what the black points here are alluding to. 12-13, because of the very limited maize production that we saw stocks to use ratios bottoming out very close and below 15%, and that's historically very, very low. The forecast for 13-14 is, yes, we see a rebound in stocks, and so a rebound in the stocks to use ratio. But if we were to look at this from a historical context, it's still relatively quite low. And so the recipe for volatility is still there, and the maize market still, potentially longer term, has the ability to influence wheat prices quite strongly. To get out of this tight global feed grain situation, we need to see good maize crops, not just from 2013, but from 14, 15, and arguably 16 as well, to keep up with demand growth and to try and generate enough stocks to give enough cushion. And if we consider the weather that's happened over the last 3 years, I think it's very difficult to assume that we're going to see favourable weather consistently over the next 3 years. That's why we have a recipe for volatility still remaining in the marketplace. From a wheat situation, a similar kind of analysis here, a very strong global wheat crop, a record crop in the green bars there for this season, very strong demand. We have to be cautious about global wheat demand, because wheat is relatively strongly priced against maize, and that is going to be detrimental to the amount of wheat that's going to be used in global feed rations. We're quite unusual in the UK in that our feed industry is largely based on the usage of wheat. Globally, it's maize, which is a dominant feed grain, and wheat will feature at the right price. But because we're seeing big premiums for wheat over maize at the moment, we would expect to see some rationing of wheat demand into global feed rations, and that way may well be detrimental to overall wheat demand. The interesting thing with the wheat, though, and why wheat is becoming more and more interesting in its own right and not just a follower of maize, is the stock situation. If we look back to the big harvests of 2008 and 2009, we saw some very rapid accumulation of wheat stocks around the world and big building of the stocks-to-use ratio over 30%. Subsequent years, 2010, 11, and 12, we've actually seen a gradual decline in that stocks-to-use ratio, sort of the market gradually becoming less and less comfortable. If we look at 13, 14, we're getting close to what we call the sort of the tipping point of around 25% stocks-to-use ratio. It's not an absolute, it's more a bit of a grey area, but certainly what we're saying is the wheat market is no longer becoming less comfortable, it's starting to get into an era of tightness. That's why wheat is having to be proactive to try and preserve some of the supply to move it from what we call the luxury or the secondary demand for fat animal feed, moving it to prioritise supply for feeding people. Remember, wheat is a very political grain, and the market does reflect that in its volatility. Just really to give you a quick roundup of the global wheat situation, a bit of annotation on these slides here. And if we could go back to really the production fundamentals, this increase in wheat production, that was the initial bearishness. That's why wheat is £160 a tonne rather than £190 as we see it in the marketplace. We saw good crops in Europe and the former Soviet Union and a record crop in Canada. The US crop was slightly lower. But historically it was still okay, and what we have is quite a build-up of US wheat stocks in previous years because the US has been very competitive on export markets. So the very early signals were entering into a very bearish market. However, what we've seen, it's not a production issue this year for wheat, it's a demand issue, it's a trade issue. Two key factors happening. One is Brazil. Some crop issues in Brazil have hit quality and quantity, and if we go back to look at that area, Brazil traditionally takes a lot of its wheat from Argentina. The Argentine wheat harvest at the beginning of 2013, or late 2012, early 2013, was a very poor one in terms of production and quality. So Brazil, with the Argentine issue, with its own domestic crop issue, has had to quickly start to buy US new crop when it became available in July. Also, we see China as well buying a lot of US wheat as well. China is what we call a sleeping giant in the wheat market. It's the biggest producer and consumer, but it's generally seen as trade neutral. This year, big quality issues for the Chinese wheat crop and rapid buying of US supplies. And with China and Brazil together, they're acting to strip out a lot of the US wheat stocks. US wheat stocks are being pulled down. And over the last 3 years, while wheat has been a passenger of maize, wheat hasn't been able to trade off its own fundamentals because we've had this huge slug of wheat in the US, essentially the world's comfort blanket. Against any kind of production issues. That's being eroded now, is being basically being consumed by China and Brazil, and so the wheat market has to be more proactive in terms of how it operates in the global scheme of things. India is an interesting one, and this is where we see a lot of politics coming forward. What we're seeing is the Indian support price paid to wheat farmers is increasing year on year, and that's giving a huge cost to the Indian government. On top of that, we've got storage issues, and there's a lot of wastage as well. And so to really try and recapitalize or regain some of that cost, what the Indian government has done is set minimum export prices. What we've seen in the last few days is that the Indian government has had to cut that export price to stimulate export demand. And that potentially brings some additional wheat supply onto the market, although of questionable quality. So where that wheat can go is fairly limited. Also around the corner, we've got prospects for Southern Hemisphere production as well. Australia and Argentina are generally a relatively small part of global production, but they export a disproportionately high amount of their crop to the market, and that's what the market's waiting for. So we're waiting for these additional supplies to come forward, and that may well be a bearish factor, price negative, as we get into the new year, because if you look at the geography of these markets, assuming they can get the quality, Australia is well placed to meet the needs of China, and Argentina, we know, is a traditional supplier of Brazil. So there's going to be a bit more competition as we head into really early 2014, and that may well erode some of the wheat price and may well consolidate some of this wheat price premium that we've seen over the maize market. This is essentially what's been happening in global trade. We're used to seeing Egypt as the world's biggest importer, and that's normally a bit of a price-setting mechanism. Nobody really cares about Egypt this year in terms of its influence on the market. Yes, it is likely to remain the world's biggest importer, but it's really about Brazil and China to date. Brazil will always be quite a big hitter in imports, sort of second or third, depending on other countries, but it's the change of those origins, moving away from the South American bloc to find alternative supply. China comes out of nowhere to become essentially the world's third largest importer of wheat from like something like 17th or 18th of them we're used to, and certainly the highest level of Chinese imports we've seen for nearly 20 years. From an EU situation, the EU has been really benefiting for some very rapid export pace. And all you need to really worry about on this slide is on the far right-hand side, and these are the supply and demand estimates coming from the EU Commission. EU has been granting export licenses very, very quickly, particularly for German wheat. German wheat is of a reasonable quality and is benefiting from quality issues in areas such as Canada. So the world has been after German quality this year, and that's been supporting European export pace. Again, the green areas is really what we're interested in, and essentially the Commission have been forced essentially to increase the export forecast by over 2 million tonnes. Look at the stocks-to-use ratios in these diamonds on here. Last year we got nearly as low as 6%. The September forecast suggested we'd be around 9%. Now the forecast is that we'll be at 7%. So the European wheat market is in a reasonably delicate state. There's no real build-up of stocks. Contrast it back to 2008 and 2009, where we were sort of really getting into the mid-teen levels there. The one caveat to all of this is that big blue section of that, and the impact on demand for feed for wheat. Wheat is an expensive feed grain, and so we expect to see demand substitution, and that may well help relieve the tightness we're seeing in the supply and demand. But there's a lag in that information coming forward. There's a lag in sort of global feed compounders noticing there's a price differential and switching away from wheat into maize, certainly for the second half of the season. If these premiums persist, we would expect to see some rationing of wheat demand for feed usage. Just to touch on what's expected around the corner from Australia and Argentina, more important this year in my view because they're there to help quench some of that demand from Brazil and Argentina. Crop prospects for Australia in the green bars here, close to 25 million tonnes. Very timely rains in September. Some concerns of some heat in the latter parts of the growing season, but nothing major. It may well eat away a bit of yield at the fringes, but certainly it's a reasonable crop, not a record-breaking crop, but not a 13-million-ton crop like we saw in 2006 and 2007, which helped spark this volatile era that we're into. Argentina expected to get a crop of just over 10 million tonnes at this stage, but it's one that the market's going to be watching quite closely. And this information is quite sensitive. The market is very sensitive to this information. We only saw it a couple of 3 weeks ago when the Argentine ministry put out the wrong crop estimate. Instead of estimating a crop of 10 million tonnes, they estimated a crop of around 8.5 million tonnes. That quickly put European wheat up through 200 euros per tonne, where it still lies. It just emphasises how sensitive the market is to this information coming from the Southern Hemisphere. Let's touch on the UK situation, and it's fair to say we'll all be aware that the UK is in the second of two consecutive very extreme years. The graph here looks at production in the black lines. We had a low crop in 2012, an even lower crop in 2013, the lowest crop in over a decade. Therefore, estimate this somewhere just over 12 million tonnes. The difference between this year and last year comes down to quality. We've had 2 years of small wheat crops. Last year was about poor quality. This year is about very, very good quality. And essentially, that shifts the emphasis into the feed wheat market. The milling wheat market, milling wheat availability, looks more normal. Not completely normal, but it's certainly relative to feed wheat looks more normal. The supply issues are in the feed wheat market at the moment, and this is giving relative support to the feed wheat price. In a normal year, when we're producing around 16 million tonnes of wheat, we have to have some of the cheapest feed wheat prices in Europe to basically be competitive for exports, largely to Europe, but sometimes third country. This year, because we have no feed wheat essentially to export, we're able to be some of the most expensive feed grains or feed wheat in Europe to restrict exports, but also stimulate imports of maize. Grain maize, largely from Europe, but also from Ukraine, is going to be important to the balance of the feed grain market in the UK. The green area here is the domestic demand, and so for the second consecutive season running, we're running into a deficit situation, so we need to draw down carryover stocks from last season. Also, a relatively high reliance on imports of wheat, probably not as high as what we saw last year, because this is a feed grain issue and not a milling wheat issue. And so with a feed wheat issue, we can see substitutions to things like barley, to oats, and to maize. And that's what the market is trying to do. It's trying to restrict the amount of wheat that ends up in the feed market. And we will see substitution, and we are seeing substitution. Moving on to barley, and you could almost say barley is the mirror. Sorry, moving into the quality first for the wheat side of things. And this just shows you the rebound in the quality. The bars here are the specific weights. And you can see coming out of the 2012 low, we've seen a huge rebound in the samples achieving good spec on specific weights. Not as high as the vintage we saw in 2011, but certainly it's up there. Certainly a more normal, probably a better than normal year for that. Proteins in the triangles here show slightly lower year on year, but I think with protein, we can't look at it purely from a quantity factor. We need to look at the quality as well. Last year, a lot of the protein was held on the outside of the grain, wasn't actually functional protein. This year, the quality of the protein itself is much better. It's held within its functional protein. It's providing a value within the miller's grist. This year, there's a message on milling premiums. Milling premiums, because we have the better qualities being pushed from below. But this isn't a year to get hung up on milling premiums, in my view, because it's being driven from two sides. Firstly, from the rebound in the quality that we have and less of a need to import milling wheat, and so that puts downward pressure on the milling premium. Unusually, what we're seeing, though, is this force from beneath, because our feed wheat price doesn't have to be the cheapest in Europe, and because it's having to regulate feed wheat demand, we're getting pressure from beneath. And so that's what's squeezing the milling premium. So I don't think we can really get too hung up on the milling premiums this year. This is what I wanted to talk about, which is this is the barley. This is a bit of a mirror image to what we're seeing with the wheat supply and demand this year. The black line indicates a rebound in production to over 7 million tonnes, the largest UK barley crop in 15 years. This is the largest barley crop in modern times that will not be balanced by the use of intervention. If we go back to 2009, where we saw another year where we saw diversion of land from winter wheat into spring barley production, some of that production was balanced by selling into intervention. We will not be using intervention to balance this year's barley crop, and the market will have to do it itself, largely through exports, but also to an extent through additional feed demand. Barley is relatively competitive into feed rations, but there are technical limitations of how much barley you can use in essentially pig and poultry rations. It presents quite an opportunity for the ruminant and the dairy sectors, but that's only a limited pot of demand. So we will see increase in feed barley demand domestically, but it's going to be limited, and we're going to have to look to the export market to try and balance our supply and demand. And it's likely that we'll carry over higher levels of stock into next year as well. So the barley market needs to export, and needs to export quite aggressively, ideally before we see new crops coming forward from Australia and Argentina, which is going to bring more competitiveness. Oats is a big issue for the market this year, essentially because of this movement from winter cropping to spring cropping. We're looking at the largest oat crop in 40 years, taking us back to an era when we were using oats to feed horses, essentially. And again, it's about balancing the supply and demand. It'd be very difficult for the UK to export all of this surplus of oats, because it's quite a competitive market, especially given what's going on in Scandinavia. What the market is having to do is price in a way to try and encourage additional domestic demand, and that domestic demand in the form of additional feed demand. At the beginning of this week, we've got first indication that feed oat prices have now fallen below £100 a tonne. Milling oat prices are somewhere in £110 to £120 a tonne, depending on where you are. If you relate that to the feed wheat market, that's a massive spread in prices, and that's the oat market really trying to capture some demand to try and balance this million tonnes of oats that we've got. There are longer-term implications. What we would tend to expect to see is a knee-jerk reaction to this, depending on what contracts are available for 2014. And so what oats is turning into is a bit of a Cinderella crop almost. It's almost turning into a bit of a boom bust situation. And what is a niche crop, it really needs to compete for the right kind of acres. So there's a bit of a sustainability issue, to my mind, in UK oat production. That's the UK situation, just conscious of the time. So we're going to move on now to look at some early new crop expectations for the grains. And these are very new, very, very early expectations, all subject to change as we go forward. But this is the information that we're seeing so far from a global perspective. From a European point of view, we're expecting to see an increase in the wheat area. Essentially, because we've got this spread in the wheat and the maize prices again, wheat actually looked relatively competitive, and European farmers are doing the logical thing and planting more wheat. That comes at the expense of the grain maize area and the spring barley area. The forage maize area, particularly in areas like Germany and Poland, looks to be quite strong relative to history, as we see strong demand from the AD sector. So we need to split out the grain section from the forage section, importantly. So that's...